Open Your Eyes is brought to you by the Belize Bank, our country, your bank.
Good morning and welcome to Open Your Eyes.
Start your morning right.
I'm Sabrina Daly.
And I'm Isani Cayetano. Good morning.
And good morning, Isani.
Good morning, Sab.
How are you doing?
I'm good.
It is Wednesday, Wednesday.
Wet Wednesday?
Wednesday, not Wet Wednesday.
It's too early.
Yeah, it's okay. You haven't woken up fully as yet. But yes, it is a beautiful Wednesday morning, and we want to say thank you to all of you guys for tuning in wherever you are, locally or abroad. Thanks for starting your morning right here with us. Yes, Isani, so we have quite a few topics that we want to jump into for our What's Buzzing conversation. I think the first one that would be fitting to discuss is what would have been the headline in last night's newscast. And that was a press conference that was held in Orange Walk by the Belize Sugarcane Farmers Association.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, sorry.
Yeah, so they were, of course, sharing their discontent as it relates to there seemingly not being a commission of inquiry that is set to take place with the Belize sugarcane industry, saying that the Prime Minister is making petty excuses. I wanted to get an overview on what you captured that story to be.
Well, you'd have to be able to give it a broader context, mm-hmm. right? Because yesterday's press conference with the BSCFA did not happen in isolation of other events that preceded it.
Right.
You would recall in the earlier part of this year, in January, there was this upheaval within the industry, and it resulted in a standoff between the BSCFA and BSI
mm-hmm.
over the signing of the commercial agreement. And of course, the Commission of Inquiry was part of that entire uproar. And the government of Belize, primarily the Prime Minister and the Minister of Agriculture, were essentially mediating to try to broker some kind of a workable agreement between both parties. So that's the sort of broader context. I think what is the irony here, or perhaps what has been spoken into some reality, is the fact that in the wake of the agreement that was signed back in January after the impasse, the leader of the opposition gave me an interview right downstairs of this building
mm-hmm.
where he essentially said, in 3 months, there still won't be any commission of inquiry, and he listed out everything. And so the irony is, it's seemingly a reality, right?
Yeah.
3 months later, they're still nowhere near the terms of reference that would establish a commission of inquiry.
And the time frame that was given was, there was a time frame that was given that a commission of inquiry would be held.
Within three months. Yes. So what we're saying is that time frame has since elapsed,
mm-hmm.
right? And so there still hasn't been a move towards establishing a commission of inquiry to look into the affairs of the sugar industry. But as I mentioned earlier, it's not without reason. The Prime Minister seemingly has his reservations based on the legality of constituting a commission of inquiry based on certain terms of references that can be challenged legally. You would have seen this with, for instance, the Senate inquiry that's mm-hmm. ongoing.
Mm-hmm.
You would have seen it perhaps with the commission of inquiry that was held a few years ago into the fire sale of government assets, where the terms of references limit or restrict the panelists from going outside of the ambit of those or that framework, if I could use that description. So that's part of the consideration here, right? How do we now put together proper terms of references that would speak to what the work or what the powers, so to speak, of the panel would be in terms of how far they can go and so on? Because part of the argument, as I understand it, is it's almost as if though you're trying to probe into the inner workings of a private entity.
Exactly.
Right? And so what are the parameters?
Exactly.
How far can you go within the ambit of the law?
And that would be interesting to see how that would play out essentially in a commission of inquiry, because as you rightly put it, this is a private entity. What was interesting though was that the BSCFA mentioned that it's important for us to recognize that the BSI, the Belize Sugar Industries, do not own the sugar cane industry.
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting.
That's stating the obvious though. I mean, on their part, that's stating what we all know.
Yeah.
These
but
are
perhaps
all stakeholders.
That is one of their arguments of why they believe that a commission of inquiry but is warranted.
The question is, does that argument hold water? Think about it.
Because no, I understand.
They're all stakeholders, right? The miller is a stakeholder in the industry, and so is the cane farmer.
Right.
And to an extent, so is the government, right? So mm-hmm. to say that one is acting as if though it owns the industry,
mm-hmm.
I don't know that that's here or there, but that's just my opinion.
Yeah.
They have their own, and they're responsible and fully entitled to how they feel about it. They are the ones in the belly of the beast, so to speak.
What I also found interesting, and it was a bit that was shared from, I believe it was the leader of the BSCFA, one of the leaders, he mentioned that the Prime Minister should take very careful steps in these, mm-hmm. these, you know, leading up to this inquiry or the promise that was made for this inquiry, because their vote could very well determine the outcome in the general elections for Orange Walk Central. What were your thoughts on that comment?
The little boy who cried wolf. They said, if you, again, it may seem as if though I'm being dismissive, it's not necessarily that. I'm simply saying we've heard this before.
Mm-hmm.
In January, the same threat was levied ahead of the municipals, and they delivered Orange Walk handsomely.
Mm-hmm.
Right? From my understanding, with over 1,000 cane farmers in Orange Walk town who voted in favor of a PUP town council. So to threaten or to wield this once again.
Well.
Yeah, I'll leave that there.
So my question is, what are we expecting next? Are we expecting a meeting with the Prime Minister and the BSCFA again?
Well, here's the thing, and perhaps I can respond and then use this to transition into another conversation.
Mm-hmm.
We're hoping that we'd get an audience with the Prime Minister today.
Mm-hmm.
Today is the beginning of the 3-day budget debate, and I'm hoping that my colleagues would be able to ask the Prime Minister for a response based on what transpired yesterday in Orange Walk, right?
Mm-hmm.
So now, onto the budget debate. I mentioned this on Monday's Eye on the News, but it's only fitting that we kind of revisit it ahead of this morning's opening of the debate. So it's a 3-day presentation where both sides would be able to argue the points of the appropriation bill for the upcoming fiscal cycle. There are 5 members on the opposition.
Mm-hmm.
We're not entirely sure if all 5 will be present over the next 3 days to present their objection or support or their concerns or what have you. But I'm almost certain that the 26 on the other side will take turns, you know, lauding their accomplishments and, you know, sort of bigging up their constituencies and so forth. That has become you know, the norm when you look at budget debates and what have you.
Well, we did have the leader of the opposition on set with us last week, Tuesday, I believe. So I think we have an idea of just some of the points that we will be expecting. It will be
that
interesting
will
to see. Exactly.
That he will make, right?
So it'll be interesting to see how he fleshes out those points in the budget debate. One thing we do know for sure is the budget debates are always something that you want to stay tuned to. It's extremely fiery.
But I'll just say this and then we move on again too. The fact that they've expanded it to 3 days makes it a bit more digestible in a sense, because the marathon budget debates in the past, where they're there until 8, 9 in the night, was sort of heavy.
Yeah. Right?
So spreading it across 3 days makes it a bit more digestible.
I agree. Yeah. Well, what time does it start?
I believe it starts at 10,
yes,
if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, I believe so.
Yes.
And of course, that will also be shared on the government press office's social media pages, as well as our social media pages as well. But sticking to the topic of politics, there was another topic that I saw and I wanted to touch on really quickly, and it was shared by the Associated Press. And it has to do with the Vietnamese president, Vo Van Thuong, resigning amid anti-corruption campaign. And for me, it was so interesting because we're looking at the state of the world politically where, for instance, just to give an example, we saw just recently the prime minister of Haiti step down. And now we're looking at a president in one of the first world countries, Vietnam.
Just to stick a quick pin, Ariel Henry did not necessarily step down. He was forced out by all the gangs who formed a coalition in Haiti to oust him. But sorry, go ahead.
Yes, sorry. Yeah, so for me, it was more of a look at the state of the political climate across the world and watching the shift. Now, I represent a younger generation, so for me, I might not have as much context as the generations before me would. But this is so interesting watching this unfold, how these political leaders of big countries like Vietnam, stepping aside because of corruption. I don't know. Have you been able to read that article so far?
Parts of it, yes. But I try to, as much as possible, be able to contextualize things from a Belizean point of view. So while, yes, I understand the reason why President Thuong has chosen to demit office, in Belize, we're still trying to get certain aspects of UNCAC, for instance, implemented to where there is this concerted effort that we are able to tackle corruption meaningfully.
Right.
We're still not necessarily there yet. And it's the frustration of a lot of people who would want to see the country move in a certain direction where it's in conformity with what else is happening outside, where other countries have fallen in line to deal with the issue of corruption.
So that was one of the things that did cross my mind as well. I wondered, will there ever be a time that we see Belize following suit in something like this, where our leaders are held accountable and they are either, one, forced to step down, hopefully without violence, or two, they take that responsibility to step down on their own. It's quite an interesting thought.
That they are prosecuted if they are found to be culpable of any act of corruption.
Yes, yes.
Enrichment that is not necessarily declared or not justified, and all of these other quote-unquote illegalities that would have happened under their term. And that's the third option I would put there.
Yeah. Interesting. I definitely suggest that you check out that article. It's quite an interesting read.
Yeah.
But that does it. Actually, we have one more on a more lighter note, and this speaks
a way more lighter
note. This speaks to the generation before me again. But also, if you're a lover of music, you would know Dr. Dre.
You can't say the generation before you.
Yes, man.
The man is still very much active today.
No, but I'm sure you know a lot more of his songs than I do.
Well, that's a you thing.
No. But look, yes, continue.
Yesterday, Dr. Dre was given the 2,775th star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame, right? And there goes his mentee. And this is the person who he brought out that essentially put the duo on the map, right? Mm-hmm. So Snoop Dogg essentially did the induction and he gave the keynote address, as we would say, right? Albeit profanity laced, can't have it any better than that, right? Given the nature of those two, right? But yes, so for those who know the history of Dr. Dre, he is a legendary producer, right? He is responsible for the careers of many in the music industry, both in hip hop and R&B. And so while he has been recognized with a Lifetime Achievement Award elsewhere in the industry, in entertainment, he has been given his own star on the mm-hmm. Hollywood Walk of Fame. And this means a lot
yeah.
because this is reserved for entertainers who have left an indelible mark on the industry on mm-hmm. a whole. We're talking actors, actresses, musicians, so on and so forth, right?
Yeah.
And so it's a moment for persons who follow music industry, who follow hip hop,
mm-hmm.
who follow the career of Dr. Dre and his proteges, right? And so I just wanted to put that out there because, yes, this is a milestone.
You know, we didn't mention this as a point for What's Buzzing, but I wanted to insert it really quickly simply because it speaks to the Hollywood industry. But I don't know if you've gotten mm-hmm. a chance, Isani, to watch that four-part documentary series on Wendy Williams and the update of her health. Mm-hmm. It was honestly a really hard watch, and she too has a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame, mm-hmm. but it was really hard to watch because of one, the fact that this documentary started with hopes of showing that she would have a comeback.
Mm-hmm.
You would know that she had a well-known daytime TV show called Wendy Williams, the Wendy Show, but
I could speak to the generational gap between you and I then.
Yeah.
Because in much the same way you're saying that Dr. Dre was from another generation, so is Wendy Williams. She's from the early 90s.
Yeah, well, she started in radio.
Exactly.
Exactly. But I know her from TV, right?
Yeah.
So, uh-huh. but it was such a hard watch, and I was saying that because she has been diagnosed with several different illnesses, one including a form of dementia.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if you've seen it. Guys, if you ever heard about Wendy Williams, I definitely implore you.
I haven't seen the documentary, but I know enough about Wendy Williams.
But
been in the industry for a while.
The other thing, though, that was put mm-hmm. In this documentary, and what was interesting to me is her state of her finances, mm-hmm. Very similar to what have been the Britney Spears, what is that called again?
Conservatory?
Yeah, the conservatory. Mm-hmm. But hers, her finances is seemingly controlled by her bank.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the bank that she has would be Wells Fargo. And they were the one that appointed an independent conservator.
Mm-hmm.
So she's almost like ousted or not ousted, but she's like set
sideline.
Aside from
she's
her family,
from, yeah.
from her money, mm-hmm. from everything. It's so interesting. I definitely tell you, check it out. But anyways, I digressed. It's just because I saw the Walk of Fame and I remember seeing that over the weekend.
Uh-huh.
But that does it for our What's Buzzing conversation. If you have any ideas that you think are interesting and are trending online, let us know in the comments section. We might just bring it up in our next What's Buzzing topics. Moving now into our eye opener. And Isani, why don't you take it away this morning?
All right. Our eye opener goes as follows. We are not our decisions, and no decision is wrong because we made a choice with the information at hand. Our perception of the traits and characteristics that make us who we are is often tightly intertwined with how we live our life. We define ourselves in terms of the roles we adopt, our actions and inactions, our triumphs, and what we think are failures. As a result, it is easy to identify so strongly with a decision that has resulted in unexpected negative consequences that we actually become that wrong decision. The disappointment and shame we feel when we make what we perceive as a mistake grows until it becomes a dominant part of our identities. We rationalize our poor decisions by labeling ourselves incompetent decision makers. However, your true identity cannot be defined by your choices. Your essence, what makes you a unique entity, exists independently of your decision-making process. There are no true right or wrong decisions. All decisions contribute to your development and are an integral part of your evolving existence. Yet, they are still separate from the self. You can avoid becoming your decisions by affirming that a bad decision was just an experience, and next time, you can choose differently. Try not to entirely avoid thinking about the choices you have made, but reflect on the consequences of your decision from a rational rather than an emotional standpoint. Strive to understand why you made the choice you did. Forgive yourself and then move forward. A perceived mistake becomes a valuable learning experience and is, in essence, a gift to learn and grow from. You are not a bad person. You are not your decisions. You are simply human. Excellent. There's a lot for me to share, but I'll have you go first.
I have sort of conflicting views on this eye-opener. I agree in some parts. You are not your decision. You're not a bad person. But I also believe that you have the power of choice. And you, whether you want to admit it or not, should be able to determine if a decision would either not benefit you or benefit you or not benefit your loved ones or the other. So I believe that we do know at times when our decisions that we are going to make are not the best ones, if you want to call it wrong. So that's where I have conflict with that part of the eye-opener.
You would accept, however, that decisions are based on certain factors that are at play, right?
Right.
So perhaps in the moment while you're thinking, okay, given the situation at hand, this course of action may be the most appropriate. But in hindsight or in the immediate aftermath of making that decision, you face certain consequences.
Right.
You would accept that it may not have been the right step to take.
Mm-hmm. And that's why I'm saying that's the part where I have a conflict with, because sometimes we intentionally make a decision that we know is not right, you know, but we do it for, I don't know, selfish reasons. We do it simply because we don't want to go about making the better decision that might be the right decision, but it's harder to make, you know? And that's the only area that I have a conflict with. But I believe that ultimately we are not our decisions, and you shouldn't be defined by the decision that you make. I don't know. What were your thoughts overall on it, though? Because you said you had a lot to mention.
No, I always try to personalize the eye-opener and what it means to me, right? And so when I read the eye-opener, I was thinking about my past as a young man growing up in Belize City, in a particular neighborhood, where in my teens, I devoted a lot of my time to, you know, being involved with the wrong group of friends.
I
wouldn't say wrong group of friends because they're still my friends today, but in terms of the decisions we made and the activities we were engaged in and what have you, right? And so when I came to the realization that that's not necessarily who I wanted to be or how I wanted to live my life, I had to make a conscious choice to move away from that. And, you know, at times I'm haunted by the decisions that I made back then, but then I keep telling myself, well, I am not that decision. I've made a conscious effort to reshape and use those experiences to teach others, right? And so if you're looking at it from an outside perspective, then I would have made the right choices to step away from that kind of a lifestyle. But internally, we keep saying, well, had I known better, I wouldn't have even gone down that road. But then the beauty of life is that you embark upon a journey and these are all experiences, right? So then you are not that. It's just another story.
It's just a layer.
Yes. Another chapter in your life story. So I look at it.
That's true. It's interesting when we look at these conversations, because this particular eye-opener could be looked at from so many different angles. Yeah. I love the example that you gave of the decisions that you would have made as a young man and how you would have evolved through a decision that you made.
Yeah.
Which ultimately, if you look at it, both of them were decisions. You made a decision to maybe partake in activities as a young person, or you made a decision to hang out with individuals that wouldn't have benefited you or your development in a certain way that you would have wanted to go. But both of them were decisions, and that's what I'm looking at. But I agree, and this is the part where I agree with, the decision that you make does not define who you are.
Yeah.
And ultimately, we all make bad decisions at times, but I think it's simply just a decision that you made.
Bad or uninformed.
Or uninformed or whatever you want to call it. But it's an interesting eye-opener. I think it could be looked at from many angles. I'm interested to know, though, what you guys think of it. Mm-hmm. Do you look at decisions as just what it is? It's a decision and it's separate from the individual. Mm-hmm. Or do you look at a decision as something that you intentionally thought about? Do you think that we should take ownership for our decisions, and it's a part of who you are? Let us know in the comments. We want to know. Moving now into our weather update. Mm-hmm. Interestingly, Paul and I were talking about the weather yesterday, and we were informed that there was a heat wave. I believe it was on Monday. Mm-hmm. Thankfully, we did experience cooler temps yesterday. Not cool, but cooler. And now we're going to find out what we can expect today from Mr. or forecaster Derek Redon. Good morning.
Good morning.
All right, what can we expect as it relates to the general situation?
Okay, we are expecting the warm and mostly dry weather to continue.
All right. With that, what's the 24-hour forecast looking like?
Okay, mostly sunny and warm today. Showers, if any, will be isolated. Tonight, partly cloudy with little or no rain.
Okay, and the temperatures, what are we expecting?
Okay, highs today will be around 87 Fahrenheit over the coast, 94 inland, and 80 degrees up in the mountains.
Okay.
The lows for tonight, we're expecting 79 along the coast, 70 inland, and 64 in the mountains.
And our general outlook?
Okay, continuing mainly fair and warm weather. So a little warmer tomorrow, and then Friday we're expecting it to be hot.
Well, I mean, we are in the Easter season, and it's usually warmer around that time. So
that's right.
Well, we'll take what we get. But thank you so much, Forecaster Redon. We appreciate the information as always.
You're welcome.
All right. Well, if you were hoping for sun, definitely going to be out. Moving now into our show lineup, we have three great conversations to look forward to. Starting off now, on Monday, we discussed the informed care of domestic violence. Today, we will continue the conversation by asking, how do we report on DV? What are the laws towards DV? And what are signs that we don't see? Are we safe if we open up about suffering domestic violence? These are just some of the questions that we will be looking at in our first segment.
Our second segment, we will be joined by students from Belize High School who attended a regional event in Panama. They will be here to talk to us all about HACIA.
Nice. And in our third and final conversation, we'll be talking about Compliance U. So stay tuned for each of these conversations. We got to take our first break, however, and when we come back, the conversation from Monday continues this morning on domestic violence. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
This plan, I can't leave this plan. Smart Belize!
Hey there, smart thinkers. We're turbocharging your mobile experience with Smart's powered up postpaid plans. Imagine a world where your data speeds flows faster than ever. Well, guess what? We've cranked up the dial and unleashed the postpaid power of Smart's lightning-fast LTE data on all our postpaid plans. That's right, no speed bumps, more data. It's like having a limitless highway of data speed at your fingertips. Whether you're a Lone Ranger with an individual plan or a squad rolling with a group plan, everyone gets to surf, stream, and share at enhanced full high-quality speed. Switch to Smart's powered up postpaid plans today and ride the wave of postpaid power. Visit any Smart showroom or smart-bz.com for details and make your mobile experience smarter and faster. Smart, bringing people together.
No, I can't let this plan. I can't let this plan.
Here you go, babe.
Thanks, babe. How did it go? Good?
It was good.
Gal, I think it'll get hot over there.
I think I should go close the window.
Don't let this happen to you. At Design Depot, we have Oran Windows, exactly what you need to weather any storm and keep you safe. With Oran, you get strength, durability, and security. Oran features a strong double latch that closes securely, all at an affordable price only at Design Depot. With Oran, you'll always be safe.
I'm David Humes, this is Vanessa Humes. We only reveal Cool Spot. Belize Bank saves us a lot of time. Working with them, we can keep track exactly what we spend. We recommend Belize Bank 100% because we don't have to go to stand up in line, and we can check on our account right from our house. Working with Belize Bank is the best.
Are you looking for low-cost television advertising? Have we got a deal for you? Advertise on Channel 5's Daily Classifieds. Channel 5's Daily Classifieds is one of the most effective methods for introducing yourself and your business to the community. Use our Daily Classifieds to recruit employees, promote specials, promote your products or services, promote a business opportunity, increase traffic to your website, and advertise items you have for sale. Let us help you to save valuable time and money. Call us today at 280-0013 or visit us at our offices on Coney Drive to discuss how we can help your business grow affordably. Channel 5 Daily Classifieds. Advertise today.
Taking its name from the venerable father of the nation, the George Price Highway stretches 77 miles from Belize City to Benque Viejo. Originally built in the 1930s, this cross-country highway system is the artery that links Belize to Central America at the western border with Guatemala. That connection facilitates overland trade, supporting Belize's economic development. Winding its way across the scenic countryside, the George Price Highway, from Roaring Creek to Esperanza, has been fully reconstructed to meet international standards, with particular emphasis on road safety. A shorter and hassle-free commute is best enjoyed when everyone obeys the traffic laws. To reduce the number and frequency of road traffic accidents, it means that a seatbelt must be worn at all times, and the speed limit observed when traveling along the highway. It also means that pedestrians must use sidewalks and crosswalks where available. Buses should only board and discharge passengers at a designated bus stop. Road safety is everyone's responsibility. It begins with you.
And welcome back. For our first conversation this morning, we have been joined in studio by attorney Audrey Matura. She is here to speak with us about the laws as they pertain to domestic violence. Good morning, Audrey.
Good morning, and thank you for joining us again this week.
Well, you know me, I will talk about this issue as long as I have to. Mm-hmm. I mean, not just talk about it, I do my part, but part of it is education. So yeah. I'm glad you all always bring up the topic and give me the opportunity.
So there's advocacy, there is awareness or education, and then there is also the action that must be taken in terms of being able to address the individual situation that persons may find themselves in. But those actions should be guided perhaps by what the law prescribes, right?
Yes.
Let's begin there. There is a domestic situation where a man and his wife, for instance, are in a physical altercation. And regrettably, the wife comes out on the receiving end of the fists. And she wants to come forward and make a complaint or take some form of legal action against her spouse. Where does she begin from?
Well, definitely one of the first steps she can take is go to the police station. There's a domestic violence unit in every district. Mm-hmm. And we have some people who are trained. Unfortunately, a lot of people do have bad experiences because when they go there, certain biases from the individual police officer may come out. But that's ideally the first stop if you have the courage to go there. If you don't want to go make a police report, this is where a lot of people are mistaken. They feel that you have to make a police report before you go to the courts. But no, you could go directly to the family court unit and report what happened. It does not mean you have to make a police report. Because when you go to the family court, there's an intake officer. I mean, if you've been badly beaten and bruised, then you'll take your own pictures. So it does not have to become a police matter in the sense of a criminal matter. But when you go to the court for a domestic violence complaint, when you apply for a protection order, because that's the next step. The reason I so go to the court is to apply for a protection order. What is happening there, when the male is brought up to the court, when he's summoned, it's really, really a criminal process. When you have to prove domestic violence against a person and get a protection order, it's a criminal process. So you can jump apart from the police and go there. But I usually tell people go to the police station, because at the police station, they will take a report. They should take a report, and they should take give you a medical legal form and take pictures and so on. Unfortunately, I've had situations where clients come to me and say, I went to the police station and they tell me that they don't have to take my report and make I go straight to court, blah, blah, blah. That is ill-advised. Any person who goes to a police station with any kind of injuries, the law mandates that they have to do an investigation. They have to. Even if you don't have any injuries, the law provides for common assault, which is not necessarily that they hit you. They just put you in fear of being hit. So that doesn't mean that you'll have any bruise or anything, but you fear that this person would attack you. So the fact that you could go and report that and that be charged criminally, imagine you going there beaten, bruising, and all ached up, and then the police say, oh, miss, go to court. And it takes a lot of courage. And this is what the system needs to learn. It takes a lot of courage for those women to even make an admission that he has been violating me. It takes a lot of courage. Then to actually go to a court, to a police station, where everybody I know your business know. And then to go from the police station to go to the court where you sit and everybody don't know. If you don't write that from the court, to sit down by one of them chair there, darn, you're there for something serious.
Yeah.
Because nobody just goes there, you know?
Yeah.
So that would be how you first start.
I think while you've essentially laid out what the course of action should be, from a layman's perspective, I would want to think that a lot of that is there's certain pressure brought to bear on an individual who, after having been physically assaulted by his or her spouse, would go and file a report against the fact that, as you mentioned, the officer to whom you're filing this report or this complaint might have his or her own bias. Then it also depends on where you are in society, so to speak. Because face it, someone who's prominent may think twice before putting their face out there like that. And so because of that, a lot of these reports go, or a lot of these instances, I should say, go unreported. Right? But it's not to say that despite the fact that it goes unreported, the issue goes away.
It doesn't.
In more often than not, sorry, it's a cycle.
Yeah.
A rather vicious one.
It feeds the cycle.
So the non-court recourse that you can take is you have to recognize that if you're in a situation where you have accepted this abuse, you have a problem too, you know. Mm-hmm. It's not just the person who's abusing you. You've made yourself stay in a situation that it clearly indicates you have a problem. So
because you've normalized it, so to speak.
So to me, one of the key things is for women and men mm-hmm. to seek professional help. Mm-hmm. You could go to counseling, you could go to therapy and all kind of thing to help you to mentally prepare yourself to understand how to break away and walk away. Because that's the hardest part. I can take you to the police station, I can take you to the courts, and they could, everybody say, leave, 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 and you still keep going back. Because you then have a problem. And I'm not saying that because you have a problem, it justifies that you're being beaten. It most likely the problems would be that in your childhood days, you saw violence in your home, you saw it as a norm, so you accept it. It could be that when you were a child, and I always go back to the childhood because I think it stems from there, you were abused, traumatized. A lot of times these women have been subject of sexual abuse, actual sexual abuse. So when they find themselves in a situation where they're being abused further, they rationalize it. Like they just lock it out or rationalize mm-hmm. it and feel like, well, nobody else will want me. Mm-hmm. I'm damaged good. And the guy, most likely you would have confided in him what has happened, and he uses it against you. It can also be that you had a traumatic teenager event, which does happen. It could be that you came from a very loving home and your level of empathy is so high to your destruction. There's sometimes you say, like, when a nicely girl do it that rough up man. Mm-hmm. But it's because her sense of empathy, and sometimes religion causes that, makes you feel that you want to save that person. But it's not your duty to save. And trust me, I know people don't see that way.
It's not your science project.
Right, but that really happens. Mm-hmm. It really happens. And I never understood that until I had to practice family law. And I mean, I've seen hundreds of clients, maybe even thousands. Mm-hmm. And I've had to understand people. When they come before me, I cannot be judgmental. I've heard some of the craziest stories. And one of the things that I've come to conclude is that a lot of women genuinely have empathy for these men. They're their projects, as one of my son likes to call them. Mom, you don't pick up a project.
That's not a science project.
and so it stems from all of that. So those are the things that a court or the police cannot necessarily address, mm-hmm. but you have to be able to address. And I think it's time we have these very open discussion. Mm-hmm. Go get therapy, go get counseling, mm-hmm. and not feel ashamed, because there was a time.
But Audrey, you're saying very open, when in fact the issue is still very much taboo.
Yes, it is taboo. Mm-hmm. It is taboo, I agree. But I think that I see a different era has arisen. Mm-hmm. And I say that from my own experience. When I was 24, 25, I actually lived in a situation of domestic violence, and I was a journalist then. A darn good one, I may say. So a lot of people knew me. I mean, TV was a new thing then. I was mm-hmm. like the fresh face, and I felt the embarrassment. I knew mm-hmm. how it felt to have to go and report it, but I just decided to do it. Yeah. And when I went to the family court, well, first when I called the police, they refused to act. We did not have the legislation we have now. Mm-hmm. They refused to act. I had to, because, you know, as journalists, we have access to high officials. I had mm-hmm. to call the commissioner of police then mm-hmm. to ask him to please help me. And then he instructed the guys. Because when the guys reached out to my house, they were like, yo, dude, that you are like, Miss, like, what? You know, actually, that is a second level of assault on me for you to think that I should just stay there.
Yeah.
Then when I went to the family court, it was horrible. It was horrible. It was like, they looked down on you. They literally looked down on you mm-hmm. like, oh, B, you cast that yourself. That was the attitude mm-hmm. I got. So I had to fight the system. I know how it is, but honestly, we've come a long way from that. Mm-hmm. And we've come a long way because even us as attorneys are more prepared to go to court to fight for you. Those days, mm-hmm. a lot of attorneys don't want to go practice family law. Mm. At least now we have that step. I mean, it's not a lot of us who go to family court, because that's another problem. Only a few attorneys go to family court, a handful of us. Mm-hmm. We're trying to service the city and the districts, and I'm telling you, it's a lot of strain, and from a business perspective, it's not the most lucrative area of the business.
You know, Miss Audrey, you mentioned something that I think, I think while we know it to be true, it's something that we're still shocked a lot of times when it occurs, and that is when we see prominent faces in conversations of domestic violence. Oftentimes, people associate domestic violence with a situation of poverty, you know, and it's so important because I look at what took place over the weekend, the report that was made of the couple that lost their lives to domestic violence, absolutely devastating news. Mm-hmm. And it's so important, I believe, for us to reinforce that there is no bias when it comes to domestic violence.
Let me tell you, you said something that indeed is the myth or the misconception that it is about socioeconomic background, but it's not.
Mm-hmm.
Abuse is about power.
Mm-hmm.
And power does not mean financial power and political power. It means dominance over the person around you.
Mm-hmm.
So everybody has a level of power. The so-called street guy or woman has power, even if it's only over their children or their lover. So it's about power. So a person who exercises their power in a domestic situation has to be a person that comes from a background of massive trauma. So I deal with the law, but I have had to learn the sociology, psychology of it. And while I am no professional in the field, my career has forced me to read more, learn more, not only the cases, but the books about psychology and so. And then I have come to understand that, yes, the court and the legal system tries to provide a solution, but the true solution, in my belief, is that we have to start from education from the early years. Mm-hmm. Why? Because your first 7 years of your life is your formative years. And usually it's in those first 7 years that you're in a home where you are either witnessing the violence and abuse, or you are suffering it directly or indirectly. Imagine a child seeing his father slapping up and beating their mother. Imagine what that does to them. I'll give you an example of what it does. I had a case where the children came to me and begged me to help their mother. Their mother has been with their father for over 50 years. And every one of those children could have told me what they witnessed. And every one of them told me how that impacted their decision. One is an extreme alcoholic, one is an extreme religious person. One, she said, well, no man will beat me, so she's very dominant. It impacts on you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Sometimes negatively, sometimes positively. One, she pushed herself through education because she's like, I would never be in a position, allow a man to have that kind of financial power over me. So it impacts you. So when you see a person committing these acts, it has to be that they already suffered it from a young age.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll give myself as an example. I always openly say I grew up in a very violent home. At the time, of course, I don't know that. Because in the neighborhood, it was the norm that everybody beat up, then picked me, and then they fight. Like, it has become the social norm. So you do not know that this is not the norm. But your body, your whole system, I can still relive the fears I felt and the tremors when you see your father abusing your mother. Like that is a trauma that stays in your brain. No matter how old you get, it stays there.
Mm-hmm.
And then imagine as a child being beaten, literally, physically abused. So that traumatizes you. When I was then in a relationship, because I saw that, it affected either how I accepted it or I didn't.
Mm-hmm.
So as a person in a relationship, I said I would never allow that to be done to me. So I had to fight back.
Mm-hmm.
I could have said, well, it's the norm or whatever. But I think that what helped me was awareness, education, and moving out from that society and that immediate community. But what it did to me too, as a mother, because I was disciplined with physical violence, I found myself doing the same thing to my children, to my two sons especially. And it was when I was maybe like 30 years old that and having gone away to study, imagine how education can help you. And no, it was just before that, I had to do a class in sociology, 101 sociology with Dr. Arne Smith. And that changed my perspective. And I stopped the abuse. Like, I had to literally, and I recall that when I would be whipping my sons, the anger and the rage that I relived was the same anger and rage I felt as a child when I was being beaten.
I wanna point out something really quickly though, Miss Audrey, because we're talking on the the topic of domestic violence, but I think it's also important for us to discuss other factors that come under that entire umbrella.
Yes.
Oftentimes when we talk about domestic violence, we only look at either child abuse or violence within relationships where either the woman or man would be the victim. But there are other forms of abuse.
Yep.
There's financial, there's emotional, spiritual, social,
yes.
even elderly abuse.
Yes.
How does the law protect an individual that faces abuse in those areas?
Well, that's a whole lot of areas. So let me tell you, there's several dynamics
uh-huh.
that the law does not protect. For example, same-sex relationship, the law does not protect that. For example, ex-boyfriend, ex-girlfriend. So imagine you were in a relationship with someone else, your new boyfriend is your colleague here, and then your ex begin harassing him. He has no option to go get a restraining order, but he should. So it doesn't, the ambit isn't long enough.
Really?
We don't, yes. The law doesn't allow brother and sister. It's very clear. A child of the family, de facto, wife or ex-boyfriend, ex-girlfriend, but there is not a situation that covers that. So there's a lot of missing parts, I believe, at this stage in the law. For example, this very tragic story of Mr. Baptist that was killed because he began dating Miss Dawson.
So he wouldn't have been able to file a restraining order against...
He would not have been able.
So okay, forgive me.
It's a lot, right?
Yeah, but I don't want to make it seem as if though we're embarking upon a semantic argument here. But shouldn't the two things be treated separately, like domestic violence versus any other form of abuse?
No.
I'm asking because I'm thinking that domestic violence is a physical thing. Domestic abuse could be either financial, mental, emotional, or what have you. Can you go and report that your spouse is withholding money from you
yes.
and you're unable to function in a household
yes.
or whatever?
Yes, the Domestic Violence yeah. Act provides for that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So the reason we call it domestic abuse, because abuse covers a range of things, including the actual violence.
Mm-hmm.
And we interchangeably use domestic violence to cover domestic abuse mm-hmm. because violence, the way the law sees it, is not necessarily just physical.
Okay.
It's emotional violence, psychological violence, financial violence, or abuse. Use the word abuse.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, good question, because the law does provide for that. You can actually go to court and say, look, he has not touched me or anything, but he keeps trailing me.
Mm-hmm.
And when he trails me, I'm in fear. I feel intimidated. I feel harassed. Or he keeps texting me.
Mm-hmm.
That comes under psychological and emotional abuse.
Mm-hmm.
Or I've had instances where the lady said, Miss, you know, beat me or anything. I said, but it run me down. It tell me about me this, me that, how I look, how I ugly, how I fat. That is verbal / emotional abuse. You can use that. And there's financial abuse. We're outright. Either the person uses his or her economic power to hold you back. So you don't work. I mean, I was shocked in this day and age that I met women who don't have a bank account.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
And the husband literally or the partner literally controls the money. Or women who are working professionals that everybody still look well manicured and pretty and well dressed. And when their paycheck comes, a certain amount has to go into the hands of their spouse. And yes, it's crazy what I've seen. Like, it's unbelievable. I mean, I once did an FB Live because it was an issue. And
mm-hmm.
I called out, and not to put down people, but teachers and nurses are some of the category that I see suffer it the most for. And I have my reasons why I think so. Not because they're stupid or anything,
mm-hmm.
but because they're more stable. And they usually are with partners who are not financially on the books stable. They might be a taxi driver who does not have a company. So when you go to make a loan, that's the person with the economic power is the
mm-hmm.
one that the bank wants to sign off on this document. So it's women in those situations. A lot of that, it does not mean that the man doesn't work good and may even make more money than her, but the requirement of the financial institution
mm-hmm.
then puts her in a corner, and they're usually the ones that can show on paper how solid they are.
Hmm.
So yes, there is all sorts of other form of abuse. It's
mm-hmm.
not only financial. There is sexual abuse. I mean, the cases of sexual abuse are absolutely outrageous, that you hear those things and you don't believe that they actually are happening. But as we speak right now, I can guarantee you somewhere in this country, someone is being abused, some form of that abuse. So I had said earlier that, yes, I could deal with the law, but I think where our work needs to extend is in the preventative rather than trying to seek the cure. Because by the time you seek the cure, the person is actually very messed up, very messed up.
Going back to the legal perspective here, though, and the fact that the laws that speak to these scenarios seem to be very much antiquated, because
I believe
you're looking
so.
You're looking at.
Let me find it while you talk.
We're looking at several different scenarios that come to play that were not necessarily the thing back then when those laws were being drafted, right? So, for instance, if in a liberal society we've come to accept that we do have same-sex relationships, then the law has to be able to reflect the fact that it is aware that you have same-sex couples who may very well end up in domestic situations.
Oh,
but
yes.
There is no protection, as you've mentioned, for persons who face these kinds of abuses under the law.
I think they're one of the most disadvantaged category. Let me tell you why. Because first, you can't go to the domestic violence unit, to the court, because you do not fall under any of the category. Mm-hmm. And second, when you go to the police, the stigma already associated with man and man, woman and woman, and all in between, the shame that still comes with it for you to even say it. And I find that the attitude of the police officers is not the best in those situations. So then you tend to feel ashamed, you won't go report it, so you suffer more. There's no actual legal recourse, because your only real legal recourse is to report it as a crime, not for the domestic situation in which it occurs, but just a crime simpliciter. But it's more than a crime simpliciter. It's not just some random people attacked you.
Yeah.
It is your partner who attacked you, and that's in the physical aspect. Imagine being in that same situation and suffering financial abuse, emotional abuse, and psychological abuse, and the police can't address that, only the family court. But
so
you don't
question,
follow.
The question is, and I hate to put this squarely at the...
No, you don't hate at all. Put it.
I hate to put this squarely at the feet of the police department, but it has to do with the level of training that the persons who are attached to the domestic violence unit would ultimately have. Because if at the end of the day, you are tasked with dealing with the public. The public is comprised of so many different arrangements of people, right? So when they come to you, they may not come to you as man and woman. They may come to you in some other form. But if you're not open-minded to be able to receive the information, to be able to address it appropriately, then you begin to impose upon them your own personal beliefs as to what the arrangement should be, which in itself is discriminatory.
But I don't hate to say this, I'll say what is reality. The very police officers you're going to get help from are themselves either abusers or abused. If they're not abusers or abused from they were younger and are now in the police service, the very nature of the system of the police service is very abusive. If you read the Police Act, the level of authority with which they treat you is very open to abuse. I mean, your superior can there and then strip you of this, they can charge you for this, they can deduct from your salary. They have a system that I call a kangaroo court. It's just at the very nature where you cannot think for yourself, you only follow orders. The very nature of it is a system that is systematically abusive. So how can I, an abused person, go to you and you are yourself an abused person? Either you won't have the empathy because you want to, it's a pecking order, so this is your opportunity to peck back, or your level of empathy, which is really there, is very high. It could go either way, but it's usually the people themselves are abusers or abused. And it's not to put them down, it's because it's a reflection of what we have in our society. So I go back, the problem needs to be solved from an earlier age. It literally, I believe, that we do not have an effective social service to help to track down, as soon as a child is born, track down where they end up. Let the social service get in from then, because a lot of the children, and we all live here in the reality of Belize, have you passed in certain areas and you hear they're beating them, picking the tech, or you see the neglect they're going through, that in itself already festers the environment of abuse. That child will either become an abusive person or accept abuse.
And that's where I want to take the conversation right now, Miss Audrey, because you mentioned briefly about people observing or being aware of abuse taking place. My question is, what impact or what effect can the observer have where they know that an individual is being abused or abusing an individual, but nothing is being reported from the inside there? Can the observer do something about that?
Yes, you can report it. But the thing is, you report it, are the people in place? Like, you could go to human services if it's a child, you could go report it, but are you prepared to say you saw? And many times the people say, look, I want to tell you, but I don't want them to say that to me.
Oh.
So how will you get the evidence? When you go there, the mother or the father will not admit it.
The child,
you question that child there, and then they won't tell you. They're in fear. And sometimes when you remove the child from the situation, they are so traumatized that they feel that if they tell on their parents, because
they're going to get in trouble,
they are going to lose out. And sometimes where you take them is so bad that they prefer to go back where they were.
Yeah.
We don't have the best system or best facilities to hold our teenagers and our troubled children, or to nurture them to where we want. We genuinely have a problem, and we've never been a country that invests enough in these institutions. You want to curb violence at all level in this society, it has to start from a younger age. It has to start
Audrey,
there.
Here's a scenario that I brought up on Monday when we were having a similar conversation as it regards to domestic violence, right? Oftentimes the outsider, Sabrina uses observer, I'd say the witness.
Mm-hmm.
The person who witnesses what is taking place has perhaps the right to make a report and say, look, I saw Audrey being abused at the hands of Sabrina.
Mm-hmm.
That's the scenario, right? We have the videos, we show that you're bruised up and what have you, the evidence is there. But at the end of the day, what is the reality in many cases is that you and Sabrina will make up back, and then I, the person who made the observation, witnessed it and reported it, becomes your enemy.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it's
so
true.
A lot of times that is the deterrent as to why people see and don't say anything, because they tell themselves, well, that not got nothing to do with me.
Yeah.
As the truth of the matter is, when two heads go up on a pillow,
I was
the whole scenario changes in favor of the couple against the individual who saw and made the complaint.
I have to agree that is so true.
Yeah.
And to me, from a sociological, social aspect, that's deeper than the law can address.
Mm-hmm.
But what the law can do is that it should be that they can convict the person that assaulted Sabrina without Sabrina's evidence, especially where you say there's video and stuff. And the perfect example is the Rihanna Chris Brown situation. Mm-hmm. Remember Rihanna?
Yeah.
Back dog didn't want to do anything, whatever. Mm-hmm. But that didn't mean that Chris Brown wasn't arrested, charged, and convicted.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because there was already other evidence.
Yeah.
We need to reach that stage, and we're not at that stage yet.
Mm-hmm.
So I was looking for who can, who are the persons who can
report.
So domestic violence offenses means a prescribed offense committed by a person against a spouse of the person, a child or dependent of the person, or of a spouse of the person, or a parent. Nothing about an ex-boyfriend, an ex-girlfriend, same sex, a brother and sister. So you could be in the same home and your own brother is abusing you, and it does not fall under this. It's crazy. And then they explain to you in the law, they explain to you who is a spouse, and then they go de facto spouse, ex-spouse. You know, it doesn't mean that you had to be married, things like that. But I think the definition needs to Explain to that the parent means a person who is a parent or a grandparent in relationship to a child, dependent, spouse, or respondent.
Forgive me, Adrian, and maybe this is not the question for you, but I'll just put this out there nonetheless. So why is it then that we're having 16 days of activism, we have this, that, and the third, but we're not lobbying for constitutional change where the actual laws are concerned? I think that to me is the greatest irony in all of this.
Yes, I have to agree with you. I have to agree. Like, I see changes I would love to see in the law. Absolute changes that needs to be addressed. Definitely, right now, one of them is expanding this legislation. Mm-hmm. It has to be expanded. It cannot be that a person like Mr. Baptist could not have gotten a restraining order against Mr. Jimmy Young. Mm-hmm. It cannot be. Mm-hmm. It has to be, because those are our familiar domestic relations, no matter mm-hmm. how you put it, even mm-hmm. if in an extensive way. And it has to be that the law no longer requires that you, the virtual complainant, as we call in our system, mm-hmm. has to be the one that goes and makes the report and has to give evidence. No, if I witnessed it and you, out of fear and trauma, whatever, don't want to come and report it, I'm a good enough witness to say, I saw Isani beat up Sabrina, blah, blah, blah. Even if though Sabrina don't want to come to court. Mm-hmm. And that precludes Sabrina from coming to court and say, I don't want him. No court action, which is what happens a lot. Mm-hmm. So you made a very good point. I hate to say it, but sometimes I think these things are just for show. Mm-hmm. And the entities that have the power to make the changes are not mm-hmm. making the changes. The other thing I would really love to see in change is that in the classrooms, from a very early age, we literally have in our curriculum this topic. Mm-hmm. It's not just good touch, bad touch. It is, we haven't taught our children how to navigate conflict. Mm-hmm. There has to be a form of prescribed, I remember in school we had critical thinking, mm-hmm. yeah. right? So it's not critical thinking, like a prescribed thing of, I would say mediation, management, stuff like that, something relationship management, because in that children will then learn the dynamics of mother, father, parent, mm-hmm. whatever. How do you resolve a conflict? I mean, I remember as children, if we have a conflict at school, they bring us together and we say, sorry, these days you don't do that. You go home and you get a knife and you come and stab mm-hmm. your classmate, you know, things like that. So it
your
has to be...
Your parents get involved and they don't want to solve the issue. They go at each other.
Right. Yeah. It has to be that we start teaching mm-hmm. our children how to resolve conflict. It comes down to conflict. It's normal mm-hmm. to have conflict. It's normal for people to have conflict and don't have agreement, but it's not normal for you to then resolve it by violence, mm-hmm. shouting, screaming, whatever. I mean, the recent videos that we've been seeing of women fighting with women has been horrendous. Mm-hmm. And it means that we as women too have not learned to resolve our conflict with other women. Then we see the violence that men are inflicting. Mm-hmm. I mean, we are talking about domestic violence here, but the issue of domestic violence in our homes is just a reflection of violence in our society mm-hmm. as a whole.
That's
we
true.
Saw the it's the month of it's child stimulation yeah. and women's month mm-hmm. in the Belmopan market. What did we have?
A woman and a child.
But if you look at the video, the man went after what is deemed the weaker sex. Mm-hmm. He didn't run after the husband to run him down and shoot him. He ran after the woman. And he went after the children, and then the weaker one, the younger one, and a female.
Hmm.
You know, you have to look at those things. And it's Child Stimulation Month, and we're not showing that we have reached farther. Child Stimulation Month should be more than just a parade. It has to be the very thing that I'm talking about. How do you resolve conflict? And in this day and age where we have social media, and the fights on social media are outrageous. We mm-hmm. need more than ever to teach people from very young, how do you resolve from conflict? How do you walk away from conflict? How do you protect yourself from toxic people, from emotional violence, from psychological, verbal violence?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then, if we resolve it from then, because we create a better foundation, we'll have better functioning adults.
Ms. Audrey, I wish we had more time to speak on this topic. I know that this is quite an extensive one, and there are so many different areas that we could look at. But we want to say thank you so much for stopping by again and allowing us to dive a little bit deeper into this conversation of domestic violence or domestic abuse. Thank you so much.
Can I just say one thing before?
Definitely.
One little thing. There is a vigil in Belmopan at the Belmopan Market Plaza tonight at 7. Please, everybody that could go out, please go out. Mm-hmm. I for sure will go out. I think it's good for us to come together as a community and mourn together. And some of us, the reason I think it's important to go, a lot of people reached out to me like, but there's not much I can do about that.
Yeah.
It's a matter for the police. But I think as a community, we could come together and let these people know we support them. They may not necessarily be there, but families need to know that we're grieving with them. So.
We
invite everyone out.
We announced it yesterday on the morning show as well. So this is a great reminder.
Thank you.
All right. All right. We got to take a quick break. And when we come back, we'll be talking to the students of Belize High School who attended HACIA in Panama. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Technology is ubiquitous, and it's transforming how, when, and where we work. Full-Tech Systems is placing award-winning devices in the hands of information workers, allowing them to work without compromise in a world without wires, to innovate, create, and to maximize productivity anytime, anywhere. Satisfying the needs of the desk-centric, remote, and field worker, and every other worker in between, we are providing the industry's best devices to businesses going through the process of digital transformation. Partner with us today to provide the solutions that will allow your employees to work effectively and efficiently to enhance your customers' experience. Full-Tech Systems, your technology center, where you'll come for the price, but stay for the service.
Talking about the first 1,000 days of life, you're talking about from the time you're born till you're 2 years of age. This is very important to your development. This is the time when your brain develops, when you learn how to think, how to eat, how to grow. This is extremely important. This time period will determine your later years in life, how healthy you are, how not healthy you are. Breastfeeding is extremely important, and we're not doing as much as we're supposed to be doing with breastfeeding. Breastfeeding is cheap, it doesn't cost anything. It is readily available, it's at the right temperature. It is safe, it doesn't carry any diseases, but it carries all the nutrients that the child needs. A baby doesn't really need anything other than breast milk. It doesn't need water, it doesn't need gripe water, no need juice, and this is true up to 6 months of age. If we do this for our baby, we're setting up our baby to be healthy. Babies that only breastfeed have less infections. They don't have diarrhea problems or ear infections like other children. So we're really pushing and promoting the first 1,000 days of life, exclusive breastfeeding. After a 6 month period, we then need to introduce food for the baby. But we're not gonna be introducing chips and Ideal and soft drinks. If you choose to give a breast milk substitute to your child, there are certain risks that you run. When you start introducing these canned products to that young intestine, what happens is that you strain it, you make it overwork. Baby becomes constipated, bloated, colicky. Studies also show that these babies, when they get old in life, these are the ones that get obese, they get hypertension, and get diabetes.
$2,251,000 slices of watermelon are eaten by tourists each year in Belize, benefiting local farmers and processors directly. Tourism means business.
With so many different styles of light bulbs, sometimes it's tricky to choose the right one. Whether it's a screw-in, candelabra base, or pins, we have what you need. From lamps to ceiling fans, floodlights or chandeliers, we have bulbs available in cool white, warm white, or daylight. All you have to do is choose. Once you have chosen your bulb, the final choice is technology. LED technology is energy efficient, long-lasting, produces a high-quality light, and saves you money. Choose wisely and let Benny's be your one stop for lights. Benny's, quality and saving.
What does family mean to you? Form a strong bond with your family. Always remember, they may not be in the same place. Make the time you spend together fun and memorable. Ignore the petty differences. Love them while you still can. Life can be short. You can be the glue that keeps them together.
You did a great job, congratulations.
Family. Meaningful always.
When someone you love becomes a memory, the memory becomes a treasure. Channel 5 introduces The Daily Obituaries. The Daily Obituaries will broadcast all death and funeral announcements and memorials to honor your loved one's life and memories. The Daily Obituaries airs on Channel 5 prior to the evening newscast, with subsequent repeats at 10 p.m. and 12 noon the following day. It will also be placed online on our social media platforms, all for a standard package fee. Celebrate their lives and memories with Channel 5's Daily Obituaries. Honor in life and reverence in death.
Do you have information about a crime or a fugitive in our community? You can submit a tip anonymously with your smartphone using this program in safeguarding our community, also protects your identity, keeping you out of the court system, and could earn you a cash reward. Here is how it works. Download the free P3 Tips app from the Apple Store or Android Market. P3 is the provider of our secure anonymous tip collecting software. Open the app and create a PIN, but be sure to remember that number, then select your location. Next, select the type of crime. When submitting a tip, be as specific as possible. If you have a picture, video, or audio that will help officers, you can upload them from your phone. Information leading to an arrest can earn you a cash reward of up to $1,000. Once your tip is submitted, you'll be given a tip ID and password. Check back if your tip leads to an arrest. You'll be told how much you were rewarded and how to anonymously collect your cash.
Welcome back. We are having our second conversation for the morning, and this one is quite an interesting one. We are joined by our friends from the Belize High School. We have a representation of students that traveled to Panama for HACIA. Now, we're going to find out what HACIA is, but we just want to introduce really quickly the students and mentor who is here this morning. We have with us Judy Carrillo. She is a mentor and English teacher. To her left is Cortland Woods, award winner, Ethan Fuller, student from BHS, and Anthony Leslie.
Good
guys,
morning,
thank you
Belize.
So much for joining
good
us.
Morning, thank you so welcome. Much as well.
All right, so I see we have an award on the table, so that must be good news. But let's just jump really quickly and get an overview of what HACIA or HACIA is. We can begin with you.
All right, so HACIA, the definition for HACIA is
Harvard Association for Cultivating Inter-American Democracy. However, that isn't just what ASEAN is. ASEAN is an idea, an opportunity for youth like us to come together to formulate comprehensive solutions to real world problems. You have to state your points in ASEAN. You have to be there. It isn't just where you go dress up as fancy suits. You are representing your country. You are your country. And right there, we want to show them what Belize is capable of, and what we will show them again in the future what we can do. Thank
off
you.
The bat, I know that you're probably a debate student. And that's essentially what this is about, correct?
Yes. And just to add to what he said, ASEA is a debate conference that is organized by Harvard undergraduate students. And they offer three languages, English, Spanish, and Portuguese. Mm-hmm. And of course, our students participate in English. And for English, they have 7 committees. And what I was able to appreciate this year as a mentor is that our students participated in 6 of the 7 committees, mm-hmm. which provided a variety, and each committee has its own structure. So that makes it a unique experience for each participant. For example, we have PAHO, the OAS Special Mission, the Permanent Council of the OAS, CELAC, which is an acronym for the Spanish version that stands for the Community of Latin American and Caribbean States. We also have a very nice simulation of the Inter-American Court of Human Rights. Mm-hmm. So we had 4 students who were able to act as lawyers or judges. Oh. Every day they had a different role. So let's say the first day one of them acted as a judge. The second day they would act either as part of the plaintiff or the defense. And then most of the other committees, they get to represent a country, an OAS member state. Or they also have this committee where they can also represent a member of the House of Representatives of a country. This year they chose the Dominican Republic, but we didn't have any student participating in that committee, but it's still a committee that students can get exposure on what it takes to be part of the table where you have to make decisions for the country.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting to see that we are having young people take part in these debates that essentially speaks to how they would develop as adults in the future. I think it's so important. Beyond that, of course, the life skills that they develop doing these research, doing these presentations. Of course, we hear Anthony over here speaking with conviction. That comes from one, preparation, and believing in what he's saying as well. I want to take the conversation really quickly to Cortland, to my left. You are an award winner, mm-hmm. I imagine, from ASEA. Let's talk about your contribution.
So my contribution, I was a part of the CELAC, and that is period poverty and lack of access to reproductive care. And also our second topic was malnutrition. I feel like the conversation was so powerful. It was so amazing to listen to all these people talk about how passionate they are about their country, and forming solutions was so amazing to watch. Because everyone's arguing, trying to get their point across, and everyone's also trying to be heard. So mm-hmm. it was really such an amazing experience.
What does it take to prepare for something like this?
Well, of course, you have to do so much research. I'm so grateful to my mentors, mm-hmm. specifically. They've really prepared us since they've done this previously. So we did a lot of research on our topic. I had to look specifically to my country, which was Brazil. Mm-hmm. So I had to look at what do they currently have in place? How can this be improved? What have they done in the past that hasn't worked out? And what are possible solutions that we could implement in the future?
What was that experience like for you? And how do you take that knowledge or that experience and put it in a Belizean context?
Well, actually, that's a beautiful question, very perfectly asked. The experience for me, of course, it was very nerve-wracking when I first went there. I was so excited and I was so nervous because I've never been a part of anything like this before. Mm-hmm. And all the students, you know, they spoke so eloquently. It's scary to see how well they speak there. And I'm so glad our mentors prepared us for that. The way that we can apply this into like Belize itself is that it allowed me to create solutions that were not simple. they have to be based off of my country. Mm-hmm. So I can look at Belize and look at the previous solutions that we've prepared and look at solutions that we can make in the future.
Yeah. Let's take the conversation over to Ethan Fuller, also a representative of BHS and also who traveled to Panama for the HACIA. Let's talk about your contribution.
So my contribution was to PAHO, which is the Pan-American Health Organization. And for our main solutions, we looked at 3D printing clinics. And this topic that we tackled was actually, you know, how past pandemics have affected us and how we can improve it. So basically, I looked into something innovative, something forward thinking. We haven't really seen a new way of infrastructure in health. Mm-hmm. So I decided to look at a cheaper, more cost effective and a more impacting way that gives long lasting jobs to rural areas and also allows better access for health. Mm-hmm. So I looked at 3D printing clinics. And it's a very important idea because it helps actually develop rural areas. It makes people actually learn medical health and, you know, it gets them, you know, involved in that whole situation. Mm-hmm. And that's something, you know, that I really was passionate about, you know, getting the rural area involved into these types of discussions and ideas. Mm-hmm. And our second topic was how climate change affects our health. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's something that we don't really look at as much as we do. You know, we kind of look at climate change and how it affects the world itself.
Yeah.
But we don't really see how it affects us directly.
Yes.
So we looked at how we can change carbon emissions into formic acid. And that really changed a lot because, you know, that can go into mosquitoes repellent. It can go as tree fertilization. And overall, you know, it helps in different areas and it really impacts different solutions.
Wow. You know, what I hear from each and every one of you students that spoke just now is our future seems bright. It really does, because this is so innovative, the way that you're thinking to use 3D printing as a potential solution for infrastructural development and health. And of course, the conversation around climate change and how it impacts health is one that I feel like I've only just started seeing last year, for instance, when we had our COP. So I'm definitely looking forward to us having that conversation about sustainable development and climate change and how it not only impacts our environment, the world by extension, but to bring it to a more personal level, which is our own individual health. I want to take the conversation over to Anthony, because what is really interesting about this delegation here, guys, is that we are surrounded by two seniors and a freshman. Anthony is only 14 years old, but he is walking and speaking with so much passion. Anthony, let's talk about your contribution to HACIA.
All right, hello. So I was in the OAS Special Mission Committee. So the purpose of that committee was to mainly target a specific issue or even crisis in a country. So mm-hmm. what we did is that we targeted the issue of internal displacement and migration in El Salvador, which has been a pressing issue for decades in El Salvador and has contributed to violence and chaos in multiple other nations. Mm-hmm. So there are tons of solutions in this committee that was just amazing from the people there. You could clearly say that they were committed and confident. Mm-hmm. So what solutions that I did was mainly was the improvement of infrastructure and housing in impoverished communities to decrease the incentive to migrate and to target the main factor that causes violence in El Salvador, being poverty. Mm-hmm. And another solution that I also implemented to tackle the current violence, even with Nayib Bukele, is the implementation of a dedicated and educated security force on the situation of those people in impoverished communities. Our main goal was to target the people in impoverished communities who are the most vulnerable to internal displacement and the incentives to migrate. So that's what we did.
Can I get in on the conversation?
Yeah, sure.
So, the situation in El Salvador as we know it, with the gangs and the gang members being incarcerated en masse, right? They have all of these prison facilities that have been built there, housing thousands of alleged gang members. I say alleged because there's controversy surrounding the fact that not everyone who is locked up is in fact a gang member. Nonetheless, right?
Yes.
While in some parts, Nayib Bukele is praised or celebrated for being able to take a hardline position, in other areas, they're looking at it as perhaps rank and outright human rights violations, right?
Yes. So
did you factor any of that into your solution in terms of looking at that big picture?
Yes. So that's another topic that we had to talk about in our community, being the alleged human rights violations. Mm-hmm. So what we had to look mainly for is alternatives to just the Maduro policies and taking people in the hundreds and such. Mm-hmm. So that's why we wanted to target the main center that causes violence in El Salvador, being poverty, which mm-hmm. would decrease the violence effectively overall.
Mm-hmm. Judy, let's talk about the overall performance of the student body delegation that traveled to Panama for HACIA. We know that Cortland is an award winner, but let's talk about the overall performance of BHS.
I must say that I'm very proud of the performance of all 18 students. Mm-hmm. I think this was a year where they had more opportunities to participate in the discussions, because the good thing about HACIA is that no one is going to call you to raise your placard. Mm-hmm. You have to be ready to do so if you wish to contribute to the discussion.
Mm.
And one of the things that they have to prepare before they go is an opening statement. But it's not guaranteed that they are going to deliver their opening statement if they don't raise their placard on time, as the speaker's list has a limit of 10 delegates.
Oh.
And this year, I was very surprised and happy that in most committees, our students got the opportunity to be in that speaker's list.
Mm-hmm.
And as I was moving around each committee, because they were all in different rooms, I was able to see them participating, using their notes, because one of the important things that has to do with debate is the use of evidence. So you can raise your placard and say that you want to contribute to the discussion, but if you have nothing to back up your point,
it has to be facts,
then it's not going to be something effective mm-hmm. and something that other countries would be interested in collaborating with you.
Mm.
So overall, I would say that they did well. For most of them, it was their first time, so I hope that this experience will motivate them to go again next year if they have the opportunity, because now they know what are the things they should look for.
Mm-hmm.
They know in what ways they can improve for another HACIA experience.
Mm-hmm. When we think of debates, it's something that takes a lot of skill to develop, to be in a place where you have to defend your point, but to also hear other points and to still reaffirm your point is the challenge at times, because your opponent could have factual information as well. How do you converse or dialogue in a debate in that sense when your opponent has fact-based points, but you're also trying to hone in on your point?
I feel like that's something so important. Something that really helped me out was looking at previous statistics in my country.
Mm-hmm.
And my one was more not of like a debate where people are against like each other, but more of like we're asking questions about each other's solutions.
Mm-hmm.
We're really all trying to work together for a better future. So it's not like anyone would disagree, like, no, women should not have access to reproductive care.
Mm-hmm.
It's just everyone's trying to agree, like, along the lines of their country's, mm. like, morals.
Mm-hmm.
So something that really helped me out was going back to statistics that have previously been brought up
mm-hmm.
and writing that down. If anyone else said something about Brazil, I would also write that down. And those things, they helped me formulate a better way of saying things
mm-hmm.
when I would get up and raise my placard and say, I have something to say.
Mm-hmm. Was there any fear from, I know that we are only joined by 3 of the 18 students, but did you guys have any fear approaching this conference?
Well, you know, when I first looked into HACIA, I was kind of in over what I was expecting. The mm-hmm. first day I got there, I saw all these students, all these delegates, and I was just thinking, wow, they are prepared. They came here and they are not joking around, you know? Mm-hmm. And I felt a little overwhelmed in terms of how I personally felt, but I kind of worked through that. And after the first opening statements, you know, I was like, you know, I think we have a chance of doing something really great here.
Mm-hmm.
And that in total, in general, is just something that like I really learned from, because mm-hmm. that experience, you know, it built more aggressive speaking, and I kind of feel like I'm a lot more better speaker, a lot talented in terms of that. And in general, it's just something that I appreciate, because mm-hmm. it's like a very open, eye-opening experience, and it really built a lot of leadership.
Yeah.
So,
Anthony, yes.
Do you believe that perhaps with this takeaway from the experience that it would lead you in a certain direction where you want to go professionally down the road?
Yeah, well, looking into ASEA in the beginning, I wanted to do some sort of politics again to human rights or just in general help my community around it. So this experience kind of even more pushed me into that line and pushed me down into the future. I really want to get into that type of position and role.
That was a similar question that I would have posed to Anthony in particular, because knowing that you were a freshman and obviously one of the youngest, I imagine, from the delegation that attended ASEA, where did your interest come from?
My interest? So I've always loved debating since Standard 6, because I had a little debate that we did for a political party simulation. Mm-hmm. So another thing about fear of the debate conference itself. So you cannot be scared when you are debating. Mm-hmm. You have to be confident, enthusiastic. If the others see that you're nervous, if they see that you're scared, they see weakness and they'll try to exploit that specifically. So you need to be confident. As my mom said, nerves just make things worse. Mm-hmm. You cannot be nervous. In order to state your points and to reaffirm them when others try and to get rid of them by making their own claims, you have to be confident.
Yeah. So what do you want to be when you get older?
When I get older? So I really like aerospace engineering. However, I'm trying to, politics and mainly lawyers or diplomats, I find interest in those as well.
Yeah.
However, even with these debate conferences, you can implement these into other workplaces so that you can be a workplace leader and take initiative in your own workplace.
I have to write down your name, Anthony, because I hope I'm alive when you become prime minister.
My God.
A lot of people have said that. Last day of committee sessions, they had like a candidate awards moment for his committee, and his candidate award was future president.
I'm telling you. No, I have to write down his name. but guys, I have to say a huge congratulations to you guys at BHS. We know that this school is one that is actively involved. We, of course, know your name in robotics, but to see that there are other areas where the student body can be engaged and can refine their skills in other areas, it's really impressive to see. So I'll use this opportunity to ask if anyone has any last words.
Well, I would just like to thank you guys for, having us on here and being able to talk and inspire maybe other students to join this. Honestly, it's such an amazing experience, not only for the educational, but also for making connections and speaking to other people. There are so many people that I met who are so passionate about what they're talking about. And, it's just really an amazing experience. I really would suggest and recommend to everyone to join.
Mm-hmm. ASEA is something that is going to help our future. It's helping develop our youth, it's helping develop the leadership positions, and getting into this type of role and getting into this democracy, getting into this position at ASEA, that's something that's going to affect our future for the better, and it's going to help develop all the youths that get involved in it, and it's going to help, have a better future for at least our country. So
firstly, I'd like to thank you guys for having us here. But mainly, I'd like to thank my mentors, mainly being Miss Cario, for assisting us in this conference that went so well. But also my students, the students here that helped me so much. So because here, we are the future of Belize. We're the future. We're going to be the people that are up in the House of Representatives, the political parties. We're going to be the future. We're going to do things for the better of Belize, because that's what we need to do in this Belize, in this country. We need to show the world what we can do. We need to show the world that Belize's future is a bright one. Thank you.
Thank you very much for having us, and we hope to be back as well.
Absolutely, you're always welcomed.
Thank you.
Well, we got to take another quick break, and when we come back, the conversation switches over to Compliance U. What is Compliance U? Find out when we come back.
Hello, friends. I'm Dr. Bob Roberts with another 60-second sermon from God's Word. The Bible says, I went by the field of the slothful and by the vineyard of the man void of understanding. And lo, it was all grown over with thorns and thistles, and covered the face thereof, and the stone wall thereof was broken down. I have often thought that if at death we found there was no God, no heaven, no hell, still the teachings of Christ in the Bible have made this world a better place to live in. Christ not only changes one's heart, but his mind, his destiny, his attitudes toward himself and toward others, his work habits and his ethics, his morality, but also his attitude toward his country and the community in which he lives. It is said that many years ago, Cardinal Newman visited the coal mining towns of England. He came upon some towns and villages that were dirty and smutty, and yet others he found to be exceptionally clean. The houses were clean, the yards were clean with beautiful flowers, and the people had a sense of pride in themselves. He asked someone what the difference was. They replied that there was a man by the name of John Wesley who had come and preached Christ, and when he left, things were different. May those who bear the name of Jesus Christ make a difference in their communities. Today's 60-second sermon has been presented by Christian Foundations of Faith in cooperation with the Baptist churches in your area.
I'm connected.
Yo.
I'm connected.
We're connected.
Create the perfect broadband bundle that fits your style with Smart Connect. With the Junior Bundle, get 50% off your national calls and up to 6 gigabytes of data at no extra cost. Get postpaid added for an additional cost of only $25 with the Prime Bundle. Stay connected with unlimited smart-to-smart calls plus 6,300 megabytes of data and free international minutes. For the family, pay $28.13 more and get the Binge Watchers bundle with Netflix. This bundle gives you 4 profiles with unlimited streaming on multiple devices. Visit a showroom near you to sign up and personalize your own bundle combination with Smart Connect. Smart, bringing people together.
From now on, when you visit Uno, you will experience an A-plus power in all fuels. Dynamax Plus, the formula with the ultimate technology in additives, provides an A-plus power and A-plus performance. Dynamax Plus, A-plus power and A-plus performance to reach further with less fuel consumption. Dynamax Plus, available in all fuels. Uno, a different energy.
Play Mega Bingo for the change.
The Mega Bingo Progressive Jackpot is getting bigger. It's now the time to win it all. $366,525 can be all yours with a single $2 Mega Bingo ticket. So make sure you get yours. Lots of prizes are won every show. So make sure you don't miss your chance this Wednesday, March 20th. The live game airs on Channel 5 and Love FM at 8 p.m. Or play the game online by logging into Facebook or YouTube. Just search for Belize Mega Bingo. So tune in for more chances to win. You don't want to miss out. And remember, Mega Bingo is the game.
What did you mean earlier about climate change, Mom?
Well, when I was your age, I remember beautiful coral reefs and healthy beaches. The summers weren't as hot as they are right now, and the rainy season meant that it only rained when it was supposed to.
And then what happened?
The weather just started to change, and storms got worse. Coral reefs started to die because the ocean was getting too warm, and crops started to die because there was not much rain. You know, we realized as adults that we were doing something that was causing this.
What were you all doing?
Same thing we're doing now. Not using clean, renewable energy, chopping down too many trees, and even polluting the air with gases, such as the gases emitted from our cars when we drive around.
We need to help before it's too late, Mom.
We can't let it get worse.
What can I do?
We can raise our voices.
With 35 million dreams, aspirations, and futures at risk in CARI Forum, we need your voice in our story against climate change. Acknowledge. Commit. Act. This message is brought to you by the Caribbean Community Climate Change Center under the Intra-ACP Global Climate Change Alliance Plus program and is funded by the European Union.
Are you looking for low-cost television advertising? Have we got a deal for you? Advertise on Channel 5's Daily Classifieds. Channel 5's Daily Classifieds is one of the most effective methods for introducing yourself and your business to the community. Use our Daily Classifieds to recruit employees, promote specials, promote your products or services, promote a business opportunity, increase traffic to your website, and advertise items you have for sale. Let us help you to save valuable time and money. Call us today at 280-0013 or visit us at our offices on Coney Drive to discuss how we can help your business grow affordably. Channel 5 Daily Classifieds. Advertise today.
And welcome back. For our third and final conversation this morning, we have been joined by April Alvarez. She's the representative of Compliance U International Limited. Many of you guys are wondering, what is Compliance U? You'll hear all about it shortly. Good morning.
Good morning.
Ms. Alvarez. Hi, good morning. Thank you for the introduction. Yeah. So basically, Compliance U is a local company in Belize, mm-hmm. which offers more or less what we will talk about. They offer services in the aspect of compliance. Mm-hmm. You may wonder, what is compliance? So compliance is basically meeting requirements, whether it's legal requirements, mm-hmm. business requirements, operational requirements. Mm-hmm. And Compliance U focuses more on the legal requirements and meeting those across a wide section of different legislation, particularly the Money Laundering Terrorism Prevention Act, mm-hmm. right? And so we've seen over the years, especially the past decade, where Belize has been assessed twice under the Financial Action Task Force international legal requirements. Mm-hmm. And we've seen where Belize have undergone this assessment. We've done the previous assessment to the 2023 assessment, which was conducted in last year. Mm-hmm. We had some challenges coming out of that assessment, and we've seen where Belize had to enhance certain requirements across certain big business sectors. Mm-hmm. I'm sure some of you would have come across those, particularly in the banking field, where all of a sudden people were required to present IDs,
right.
Present some document to verify their address, mm-hmm. certain things like that, asking right. certain questions to gain an understanding of that person.
It's interesting because AML seemed to become a thing fairly recently,
yes.
right? In the financial sector particularly, mm-hmm. where, as you mentioned, gone are the days when we could have done certain transactions without necessarily thinking or believing that we needed to corroborate it with certain documents and what yeah. have you. But with the whole issue of anti-money laundering, mm-hmm. now every transaction requires certain proof or certain documents.
Due diligence,
that, yeah,
yeah.
It's
right.
part of the due diligence process. How do you find that in terms of perhaps persons who want to establish a business, for instance, but they need to be able to fall in line with what the regulations are from a legal perspective?
Well, we have to understand that the dynamics had changed previous to this decade and decades mm-hmm. before, coming off where we saw an increase in human activities, particularly in the financial crime area. Mm-hmm. And so the requirement came about due to that heavily. Most people would associate money laundering only with, or mostly with, the act of drug trafficking.
Mm-hmm. Right.
However, it spans crime. Beyond that. There are mm-hmm. other financial crimes that people commit, which is predicate, which precedes mm-hmm. to become an act of money laundering. Mm-hmm. And so we could see where the requirement is, you know, the old saying that says the good must suffer for the bad. Mm-hmm. And in order to establish some type of trust, we've moved into the era and we're now living in the era where you must provide some solid documented proof mm-hmm. of that, right?
Yeah.
You mentioned due diligence, and that is the core work of what Compliance U is mm-hmm. about. So just to give a background of more or less what due diligence is. Due diligence is basically establishing the true identity mm-hmm. and the authentication of the person or persons you're doing business with, whether it's a natural person or it's a legal yeah. entity.
You mm-hmm. know what I've observed? There's usually a compliance unit or a compliance department, obviously in financial institutions, but also in other areas of business too, for instance, insurance. Right. Could we talk about what would be the reasoning of having a compliance department or a compliance representative in an area like insurance?
Sure. And it's not only the financial sector, we will get into the part for insurance, but they've required, and it's a legal requirement, it's both international and local requirement,
right.
Where we must establish a unit or a representative mm-hmm. or an in-house particular person who deals particularly with compliance.
Yes.
You would wonder why the financial sector. It's not only there, it's spread across to the non-financial sector where it includes professionals such as attorneys and accountants. Mm-hmm. The insurance industry falls under the financial sector.
Okay.
Like, for that sector, you'd say, for example, let me give an example. What could happen under the money laundering? What an instance of that could happen? You have an insurance for a home mm-hmm. and you don't know how that person acquired that property. Mm-hmm. We know that proceeds of crime come in large amounts, mm-hmm. right? And so a lot of times criminals invest their proceeds from these crimes into actual assets.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So you insuring that particular asset, whether it's a home or a vehicle, you're insuring a proceed of crime. Mm-hmm. And that particular asset is basically tainted because it's a proceed of crime.
Right.
And that is why they need to
then
establish.
By doing so, in essence, you're seeking to legitimize it.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. And it comes, you spoke about that's part of one of the stage mm-hmm. of money laundering, which yeah. is legitimizing your proceeds,
yeah.
You know, via assets mm-hmm. or whatever type of business activities people endeavor on.
So let's look into other areas then of where compliance is important that is not considered financial institutions.
Okay. International standards and local standards as well has established that there other sectors within and functioning within society that can be victims, or they wouldn't even know part of money laundering regimes, right? And those are considered designated non-financial businesses and professionals.
Mm-hmm.
Some examples would include auditors, accountants, attorneys.
Speak to attorneys specifically, if you don't mind.
Well, on the basis of attorneys, they're involved in a lot of cases. Mm-hmm. They know the law,
mm-hmm.
but we know that not everybody is 100% straightforward mm-hmm. or has high integrity. There are some people that may be rogue, or in another aspect, you can see the reason why they would be classified is they will be able to recognize such activities,
mm-hmm.
right, based on their expertise,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm. So. Essentially, the role of Compliance U International Limited, let's talk about that. For maybe establishments that have not set up a compliance unit or have a compliance representative, can they seek out this service from Compliance U International Limited?
Right. So Compliance U International Limited offers their core basis on due diligence, that is mm-hmm. establishing the identity of persons or legal entities that you're doing business with.
Right.
Yes, that is their reason. So they use resources, local resources as well as international resources to establish people's background information that you're Miss Sabrina Daly, I am Miss April Alvarez, and I am from this said country, and I am from this said background,
mm-hmm.
and that my history or my record is clean, I've been mm-hmm. fair, I've been honest and integrity. Or, for example, if you do a world check and you put in such a famous name like Mr. Osama bin Laden, and that's just an example,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
you'll find that it will give us a lot of background information about his activities mm-hmm. in terrorism particularly,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
right? So basically, Compliance U establishes that person's background and give you that solid documented proof that this is the person and this is the history of that person, yeah. or this is what the person basically
In essence, what it does is pretty much establishes your credibility as an individual.
Right, mm-hmm. exactly.
And it's so important for a business, whether financial or otherwise, to establish some form of compliance or due diligence, because it not only protects the business, but the individual doing business with that person as well. Is that fair to say?
Right, yes. So in doing any type of due diligence checks, it has a benefit to you as a business to do it. And it's not only one benefit, it stems across. I have classified four benefits, right? You get to meet your legal requirements. Mm-hmm. You get to understand the person or legal entities you are establishing or endeavoring on doing business with, whether it's a customer, whether it's a business partner, you're going into partnership with anybody, whether it's a vendor that you're making a purchase from. And you can also conduct due diligence on your employees before hiring them, looking into their background. And so compliance you brings this about, being able to have them do that work for you on a professional level and present that to you.
Excellent. Mm-hmm. Well, for anyone listening in and they're interested in accessing the services from Compliance U International Limited, how can they do that?
Okay, so Compliance U has an established website, and the website offers a suite of their products and services that they offer. You go on the website, it is so friendly, you can go there, click on whatever services you may need, and you can also find the contact information such as email address, different phone numbers, and there's also a link to send directly to them any queries you may have, right? And seeking any particular services that is offered up there.
All right, well, Ms. Alvarez, do you have any final words, anything else that you have missed that you would like to mention?
I would just like to say, let's get into the culture easily. Complying with legal requirements as well as international requirements, it sets an easier tone for Belize as a country, and it helps these industries more productive going forward. It's an easier flow for them, making everything easier for Belize as a country and a whole. It's easier to move in that way.
All right. Well, thank you so much for stopping by and sharing the importance of compliance and also how persons can access the services of Compliance U. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having us as well.
Yeah. All right. We're going to take our final break. And when we come back, we wrap things up.
So the doctor has given me 5 days off. How do I get paid from Social Security?
This is how Social Security works for sickness benefits. First, you must check that you qualify. You must be employed when you got sick. Have made 50 paid contributions. Have made 5 paid contributions within 13 weeks immediately before getting sick. To ensure that your processing goes smoothly, be sure to complete and submit your claim form within 14 days of the first day of illness.
Thanks, I get it now.
Visit our website or contact any of our offices to have someone assist you. Also, be sure to visit our Facebook page and give us a like to stay informed. Social Security Board, safeguarding you, your family, your future.
Hi, my name is Lincoln Fowers and I work at UMall. 100% I will recommend Belize Bank mobile banking to everyone because it saves time, money, and gas price, because gas price is high right now. Belize Bank mobile banking just make life easier.
This plan, I can't leave this plan. Smart Belize!
Hey there, smart thinkers. We're turbocharging your mobile experience with Smart's powered up postpaid plans. Imagine a world where your data speeds flows faster than ever. Well, guess what? We've cranked up the dial and unleashed the postpaid power of Smart's lightning fast LTE data on all our postpaid plans. That's right, no speed bumps, more data. It's like having a limitless highway of data speed at your fingertips. Whether you're a lone ranger with an individual plan or a squad rolling with a group plan, everyone gets to surf, stream, and share at enhanced full high-quality speed. Switch to Smart's powered up postpaid plans today and ride the wave of postpaid power. Visit any Smart showroom or smart-bz.com for details and make your mobile experience smarter and faster. Smart, bringing people together.
No, I can't let this plan. I can't let this plan.
Are you looking for low-cost television advertising? Have we got a deal for you? Advertise on Channel 5's Daily Classifieds. Channel 5's Daily Classifieds is one of the most effective methods for introducing yourself and your business to the community. Use our Daily Classifieds to recruit employees, promote specials, promote your products or services, promote a business opportunity, increase traffic to your website, and advertise items you have for sale. Let us help you to save valuable time and money. Call us today at 280-0013 or visit us at our offices on Coney Drive to discuss how we can help your business grow affordably. Channel 5 Daily Classifieds. Advertise today.
Welcome back and thanks for sticking with us. We had three great conversations this morning. And I just want to say a special thank you to all of our guests that stopped by this morning, but also a very special thank you to you, our viewers, for sticking with us. It is Wednesday, March 20th. And if you're celebrating a birthday today, happy birthday to you. But if you'd like to give a birthday shout out, or if you have any questions, comments, or concerns, you can send us an email at oie@channel5belize.com. You can also catch us on Facebook at Open Your Eyes BZ, as well as Instagram at OYE Belize. Thank you so much for joining us. And please do us a favor and join us again tomorrow on Thursday as you open your eyes
to start your morning right.
Until then, keep your eyes, your mind,
and your hearts open.
Have a wonderful Wednesday.
Open Your Eyes was brought to you by The Belize Bank, our country, your bank.